Want me to put it back?
No, but I'm ready to go.
Go for it.
I think it's locked in now. Alright, we're locked, we're rolling. Okay. Let's do this one. You have to be quiet. See, here's where we need the clack. So we can do one of these. And if once you see the sound, you go, okay, day 3, Temple 420, take 1. And then you can see those big claps because they make a big sound thing and you just line it up. Okay. Oh, I'm going to start with the burning of the hemp. I think that's the best place to start. Guys! Mario, you just made it in the shot. Here we go. Welcome to Temple 420, day 3 of the new year. Baruch Hashem, blessed is the name, baby. I called into Dan Bedondi's show last night. Dan used to be one of the guys on Alex Jones' show. Dan is a Christian. He's in New York. I fucking love Dan. Because he talks like a New Yorker, coffee, and he's talking about the Bible and about freedom and stuff. I just love the way that sounds. I'm from California, but sometimes people think I talk like a New Yorker just because I kind of admire that way of talking. I've been talking like that since I was a kid.
It's not the size of the dog in the fight. It's the size of the fight in the dog.
All right, Mike Tyson. There's Mario doing his best, Mike Tyson. I worked for Mike Tyson last year. It was a fun experience. I got to meet Mike a few times. He was a very cool guy. All right, we got this hemp going. Just want to bless you guys with the word today. We're going to be studying the book of Revelation as we've been doing the last couple days. All right, day 3 of the new year, and we're in the days of awe right now, heading towards Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. We've been blowing the shofar every day. I'm actually getting better at it. I first learned how to do the technique in third grade. Me and Bobby Broxham, my friend who just passed away from elementary school, we signed up somehow for band or trumpet. I don't think either one of us made it the whole semester, but our parents bought us trumpets. And the trick to blowing the trumpet is to blow your lips together before you even touch the horn, and that's how you make the sound. Mario's using that clip of me not knowing how to do it at the beginning quite a few times because it's funny, but I am getting better. Alright, it's getting better, right? So by the end of this experience, our Ministry of Shouts is going to be good at blowing the horn. Obviously, we're going to teach from the book of Revelation today, and that is our ministry, is teaching prophecy from the book of Revelation. I want to finish up about Dan Bedondi's show. I called into his show last night to tell him about temple420.org, about what we're doing, and to talk about Revelation 6, because his theme last night was the mark of the beast. I believe that stupid mask and the beginning is not only the unsealing of the seven seals. Everything in the book of Revelation is done in the heptatic structure of sevens. So the first seal is where the rider on the white horse is unleashed. So we were talking about the mark of the beast, and I was saying, I believe this virus, the corona, on the bow is part of the first seal in Revelation 6:2, that the white horse that the people are riding, say white is associated with Jesus. He gives them white robes and white clothes to wear to represent purity. And this is a false purity. And people, oh, well, it's the Antichrist. Well, it doesn't necessarily have to be an Antichrist. What the Antichrist means is a fake Christ, a pseudo Christ, if you will. And who is more of a fake Christ than doctors? Okay, think about it. They wear white. Oh, we're so clean and pure. We're only here to help. Meanwhile, they're some of the biggest drug dealers in the entire world. What did Jesus do? Jesus healed people. He healed the sick, the people with leprosy, with the worst diseases of the day. He made them better. I mean, there's even a story of one lady, and it makes you wonder, was it Jesus that healed them, or was it their own faith? Because there's a story of one lady, and this is a great story. I don't know which of the Gospels it's in, but there was a big crowd, and everyone was trying to get to Jesus to get healed. And she said to herself, she's like, man, I don't even have to talk to him. I don't even have to have him acknowledge me. But if I could just touch the bottom of his robe, if I could just touch the little strings hanging off of his robe, there's so much healing power in that. I know whatever it is that ails me is going to be healed. And all of a sudden he turns around, he's like, who touched my robe? Who touched me? She's like, oh shit. You know, like, she got busted. And he said, oh, your faith has healed you. And she's like, whoo, thank God, I guess. But you know, that's the kind of story, like when people are sick, they're desperate for help, you know? And you turn to these doctors, people like Anthony Fauci, and he's been telling you, oh, remdesivir, blah, 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 blah. Try this, try that. Stuff that he knows is no good. He's quoting these, it helped with Ebola. And did it really? Or did it kill most of the people? Do they have kidney failure? And is that what they're dying of? They're filling up with water, getting secondary pneumonia, pulmonary pneumonia. And so these guys pretend like they're there to heal you, but they're not. Anthony Fauci's the highest paid government official in the United States of America. And he doesn't care about you. He don't, I mean, it may seem like a tough guy on TV. Hey, I care about you, Tony Fauci. But he don't give a shit about you. He cares about his money and serving his people. And the people it seems like he's serving is China. And that's the second seal, the red horse. I believe we're at war with China, and I've seen it for a long time, and I've participated in this war. When I was they stopped letting Chinese kids take English from American teachers, probably because of guys like me. And I used to talk, and Mario, and I used to talk to other Americans who were Christians. And, you know, obviously you see that communist guy putting his point of view on these kids in Sacramento. He just got fired from his job after being exposed by James O'Keefe of Project Veritas. All right, well, this guy, even when they went to interview him in the street, he's wearing a hammer and sickle. He might as well be wearing a Nazi symbol. The communists have killed over 100, 200 million people in the last 100 years. I don't want to exaggerate. But Mao Zedong was supposedly responsible for killing 70 million to 100 million. And Joseph Stalin, another 20 million of his own people. So, the world is crazy. Bad stuff is going down. You don't have to be afraid. You have to be aware and be prepared, all right? And that's what we're here for, to prepare you to be redeemed, to be saved, you know? And a lot of you guys don't even realize sometimes that you were being saved and that how much of that price there was. There's a story of a train engineer who had to switch the tracks from the 1800s. And he had one son and his wife had died, and it was the only thing that kept him sane was his son. And he loved this boy so much. And his son was 8 or 9 years old playing on the railroad tracks. And he couldn't hear his son, and his son was playing there, and he wasn't paying attention, and a train was coming. And he had a choice to make where he had to switch the train to kill his son, to go on the way where his son was, potentially kill his son. He was screaming and yelling for his son to move, but his son wouldn't hear him or couldn't hear him for how far away he was. And if he ran to go get him, he wouldn't have time to switch the tracks. The signals were that close. So there was a train full of people coming, hundreds of people in a train. And if he didn't switch it over, then they would surely die. But if he did switch it over, his son would die. And the man had to make a choice. And he had to switch the train over, and he sacrificed his own son so that all these other people could survive. And that's kind of what God did for you in a way. He gave you his own son, so that we could all survive in this world or in the next world. And that's why Jesus' blood is there to redeem us. And kind of, if you don't understand what that word redemption means or redeemed, if you can think of a coupon that you take to the store, hey, if I go up to the counter and the cashier cashier. And when I go give him my coupon, that's when I'm going to receive my discount or my free item. Like buy one, get one free, but you don't do it until you get to the cashier. So when you die, there is a judgment day. There is a time where you're going to be in front of God and you're going to have to account for yourselves. And none of us have lived up to his expectations because none of us have kept the Ten Commandments, the simple rules he gave us to live by. And so the only thing that you can do to redeem yourself on that day is talk about your faith in Christ, that his blood, you've counted on that as your coupon, as your redeemer, so that when you go through his judgment, you'll receive grace rather than the punishment that you deserve. Okay, so that's what this whole book is about. It's divided into two parts. The Old Testament is the story of my family, how we became the Jewish people, how the specific family from Abraham and his father in Ur, and he was told by God, given a covenant, a land covenant and a kingdom covenant, and he had to go down there in faith, and him and his wife had a child, and then he went to go sacrifice his child because God told him to, but at the last minute, God replaced him with an animal that was there caught in the bushes. And all of this is prophetic, and that's the reason we kept these scriptures and kept the story of our family, because eventually there was going to be a redeemer that would come about, and that's what we were waiting for. Okay, so when I called into Dan Bedondi, they thought I was being a troll because I talked about the weed church. So some guy was like, oh, troll, weed church, this isn't what we need. And what's really frustrating to me is the fact that cannabis was burned in ancient Israel by the Israelites in their worship of the one true God while studying the scriptures. And these people pretend like I'm hurting the body of Christ because I'm trying to reach out to stoners and people who don't like church, don't go to church, and don't believe in religion because I can't stand it myself. And I hate when they're always begging for money and not providing anything. Like, oh, this faith cloth or this and that. These guys seem like scammers. That's why we're actually creating a church business. We're giving you the word. We're giving you something that you can digest and learn the Bible by. And then we're selling you a product, whether it's hemp that you can burn as incense like we do, or it's an NFT with our badass art on it. So please support us. I wanted to talk, okay, so I was talking about yesterday about Barack Hussein Obama being a Muslim president. A lot of you guys don't know Hussein, the name Hussein, means you're a Hashemite. And a Hashemite means the protector of the holy sites in Islam. So definitely Barack Obama was a Muslim. And he hired this guy, Cass Sunstein, Samantha Power's husband, and he wanted to ban all sorts of conspiracy theories from the internet. He wanted to say you couldn't say the moon landing was a conspiracy, you couldn't say the flat earth conspiracy, or that Oswald acted alone. There was a couple other ones, there was like five or six, and I thought, oh, they're all ridiculous. Who believes in a flat earth? Who? I mean, I saw it on TV when I was a young person, very young. How could we not believe we went to the moon? I saw it with my own eyes on TV. Well, I also saw the 9/11 conspiracy, that the towers came down, knocked down by two planes, which is funny because even Donald Trump got on TV the day of 9/11 and said, buildings aren't supposed to be knocked down by planes. This is a huge deal. We should look into it. And I'm one of those people who believes that two planes did not knock down the three buildings, World Trade Tower 1, World Trade Tower 2, and World Trade Tower 7. And then they said, well, Trade Tower 7 was brought down by an office fire. The only building to collapse under what seems like its own weight at the rate of gravity because of office fire. Mm-hmm. So anyways, I started questioning all these things and looking into it. And, and the young earth thing. And so because he wanted to ban it, and he said, oh, well, Oswald acted alone. I happened to be born the day John Kennedy was murdered, November 22nd. And I think that I've always looked into that assassination and known that Oswald did not act alone, that there was a conspiracy to kill our president, John F. Kennedy. So because of that, when they said I want to ban all this other stuff, I started looking into it. And that's how I actually, even though I believed in Jesus and believed in God, it wasn't until I found, I said, well, flat earth, who wouldn't believe in it? Like, who believes in a flat earth?
I do.
Well, I actually at least question it. You know, there's no way to know for sure we're not going out into space, but water always finds a level. Why would water stick to a rotating ball? Where's the atmosphere? How come it doesn't go flying off? And since I started looking into that, the scientists have said the moon is within our own atmosphere. How can the moon be within our own atmosphere? So these are weird things to look into. And the weirdest of all for me was the young Earth theory and the flat Earth theory. And I don't think Kent Hovind, H-O-V-I-N-D, believes in a flat Earth, but he believes in a young Earth. He believes that man and dinosaurs lived at the same time, and he has a very interesting explanation for it. But anyways, that's how I came to be a deeper Christian and really, really learn more, even after I got in trouble for the first two temples. So Mario has to edit all this stuff together. We've only been taking so long to do it that I want to skip to reading the Bible, because that's really why we're here. I'm going to jump down to this one camera. Hopefully you're going to get some good shots here, Mario. Does that one work? Okay, so I need the good light. So we were in the book of Revelation, and yesterday we talked about how this word is going to bring you a blessing. So it says, from John, to the seven messianic communities in the province of Asia. So those are the assemblies or the groups of people that had come together, the Jews and a few Gentiles, to say, yeah, we believe Jesus was the Messiah, Yeshua is the Messiah, and we're going to be a community that'll meet regularly and support each other. Grace and shalom to you from the one who is, who was, and who is coming, from the sevenfold spirit before the throne, and from Yeshua the Messiah, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of earth's kings. To him, the one who loves us, who has freed us from our sins at the cost of his blood, who has caused us to be a kingdom, that is, a Kohanim for God. So we are a kingdom, part of his kingdom, and we're a priesthood. A Kohanim for God, his father, meaning Yeshua's father. To him, glory and the rulership forever and ever. Amen. And amen just means to be in agreement. It means all right, right on. So look, he is coming with the clouds. Now this is a quote part. This is what John is hearing. Every eye will see him, including those who pierced him. So does that mean including the Romans, the Romans, or the beast system that was Rome, or the specific people? Those guys who pierced him will somehow be back. I'm not sure, but that's what it says. And all the tribes of the land will mourn him. So I think when it's talking about all the tribes of the land, that's the Jewish people, the land of Israel. And so now, when he comes back, the Jewish people are going to mourn for him. We're going to feel bad. So, yes, amen. Now it's in quotes, someone speaking. Yes, I am it says Aleph and Zed, the Alpha and the Omega, the Aleph and the Tav, which would be in Hebrew, says Adonai. God, but here it says A to Z, which I know, and we usually say Alpha and Omega. God of heaven's armies, the one who is, the one who was, and the one who is coming. So he's coming back, baby. And that's what this is all about, and that's why we're learning the prophecy. I'm going to stop it there, because Mario has a lot of work to do editing all this together, finding these wonderful clips. We really appreciate you guys staying with us. We're going to get through more and more of these Bible prophecies in this book of Revelation. We really appreciate you guys being part of us. Did you move this one, Mario, or was
yes,
that
I
me?
Did, because you were sitting down.
Oh, you did? Thanks. Okay, I appreciate it. Because I'm like, hey, it looks like it's in a different place now. So we're going to study this whole book of Revelation. You guys are going to love this message, because it's a message that's going to bless you. It's going to let you know what's happening before it happens. And I'm going to let you know when I'm making shit up, like it's my conjecture, this is what I think, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you guys think. But we're only going to read the word. We're not going to change the word. We're going to read the word. And God bless you guys. Thanks for being here. Let's go out with a quick prayer. You guys, right now is the anniversary of 9/11. The sun is just about to go down, and we're going to be on the fourth day of this new year. But on the third day of the new year, you guys, I want to bless you for listening. I want to ask God that He will continue to bless you for hearing and understanding the words of His prophecy, the words of His Mashiach, His Son, Yeshua. And let's thank all of our friends in Supai for teaching us how to pray with the herbs and how to bless each other in this way. Thank you guys in Supai. Amen. And we're not trying to troll anyone. Yeah, you know what? I'll tell you guys next time about Jay Sokolow and that group who said, oh, we're going to protect Christians. And look what's happened ever since they've created themselves. People have lost the ability to go to church. You can only have so many people in church. Blah, 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 blah. What happened to freedom of religion they were supposed to be protecting? Okay. Now, I don't want to bash other Christians because I'm sure they're really nice people. Whatever. Whatever. But, you know, they said they'd help us. And then as soon as, oh, you're a marijuana church? We're not part of any drug cult. We're helping Christians. Like, we're not Christians. Anyways, God bless you guys. Thanks for being here. We shouldn't be fighting with our brothers. Forgive us. All right, bye. Adios.